This is the air I breathe. Thank you.
It is truly, truly good to be in the Man of the Living on this Father's Day. And to all of the fathers out there, I want you to know that God loves you and you are blessed if you are a father. And I want you to know that keep God first and foremost in your life. Let us go to God first in prayer as we get started with our morning service. Our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Father God, as you sit high and look low, I pray that you would draw near to us today. And I pray, God, you would drop me down in wells of wisdom and draw me up with the cords of love, that I'll be able to preach your word, that you will be glorified. Mankind can be saved. Bless those who are out there listening, wherever they may be, with the blessing that they stand in the need of. Continue to bless this choir that sings so well in the morning to get things going as we get ready for service. Lord, have your way in this place today. In Jesus' name we do pray. Amen.
Amen.
It is so good to be here on this Father's Day. And again, I want to say to all of the fathers, congratulations. Be blessed. Thank God for what he has done for you. And we are going to get ready for a wonderful day, a wonderful morning, praising God. And I want you to know that there is a word for us out there today. There is a word for us. But let me tell you this before I get to the word. Father's Day started back in 1910 from the lady by the name of Sonora Smart Darbs. She attended in 1909 a Mother's Day service. And she thought it would be nice to have a Father's Day service. And so from that 1909 Mother's Day service, she started Father's Day service in 1910. And she was from Spokane, Washington. Spokane, Washington. And just to say about a father, the job of a father is to lead his children in the ways of God. He's to discipline them. He's to instruct them. He's to teach them. And he's to guide them in the ways that he should go. And that's the duty and job of a father. But let's go to the word and get some deeper love about the father and understand the father even more. We're going to go to, in the King James Version, we're going to go to Luke, the 15th chapter, and we're going to start at that 11th verse, and I'm going to run from 11th to that entire chapter, the 11th verse, and the reading of it, it says, "And he said a certain man had two sons, and the younger of them said to his father, Father, give me the portion of the goods that belongeth to me. And he divided unto them his living. And not many days after, the younger son gathered all together and took his journey into a far country, and there wasted his substance with riotous living. And when he had spent all there arose a mighty famine in the land, and he began to be in want. And he went and joined himself to a citizen of that country, and he sent him into the field to feed swine. And he would fain have filled his belly with the husks that the swine did eat, and no man gave unto him. And when he came to himself, he said, How many hired servants of my father have bread enough and to spare, and I perish with hunger? I will arise and go to my father and will say unto him, Father, I have sinned against heaven and before thee, and am no more worthy to be called thy son. Make me as one of thy hired servants. And he arose and came to his father. But when he was yet a great way off, his father saw him and had compassion and ran and fell on his neck and kissed him. And the son said unto him, Father, I have sinned against heaven and in thy sight, and am no more worthy to be called thy son. But the father said to his servant, bring forth the best robe, and put it on him, and put a ring on his hand, and shoes on his feet. And bring hither the fattest calf, and kill it, and let us eat and be merry. For this my son was dead and is alive again. He was lost and is found, and they began to be merry. Now his eldest son was in the field, and as he came and drew nigh to the house, he heard music and dancing. And he called one of the servants and asked what these things meant. And he said unto him, thy brother is come, and thy father has killed the fatted calf, because he had received him safe and sound. And he was angry and would not go in. Therefore came his father out and entreated him. And he answered and said to this father, lo, these many years do I serve thee, neither transgress I at any time thy commandment, and yet thou never gavest me a goat, which is a kid, that I might make merry with my friends. But as soon as this thy son was come, which had devoured thy living with harlots, thou hast killed for him the fattest calf. And he said unto him, son, thou art ever with me, and all that I have is thine. It was meet that we should make merry and be glad, for this thy brother was dead and is alive again, and was lost and found. And I want to move to that 27th through the 24th verse to find us a text. He gives us a text for this service. The 27th through the 24th. But the father said to his servant, bring forth the best robe and put it on him, and put a ring on his hand and shoes on his feet, and bring hither the fattest calf and kill it, and let us eat and be merry. For this my son was dead and is alive again. He was lost and is found, and they began to be merry. That's the word of God for the people of God. And for a subject of a thought, I want to use as a subject the love of a father. A father's love. The love of a father. A father's love. A father's love runs deep. A father's love is deep, it's long, it's patient. That's a father's love. And looking at this chapter 15 of the book of Luke, We see here where Jesus has been giving some parables toward these sinners. In other words, whenever he began to speak, the tax collectors, other notorious sinners would come and they would gather just to hear Jesus teach. And many times he was teaching, you had the Pharisees and the teachers of religion would get angry with Jesus because how he dealt with sinners. He would eat with sinners. He would socialize with sinners. He would hang around sinners. And they would get upset with him. But looking at this chapter here, because Jesus demonstrated, coming from that first verse of the 15th chapter, he said, if you had 100 sheep and you lost one, you would leave that 99 and go after that one. And when you find it, you would come back and ask all your friends, let us party and rejoice because the sheep that was lost had been found. And then he went on to say he was demonstrating, he was giving parables. And a parable is nothing but an earthly story with a heavenly meaning. Jesus said, this is the way the angels in heaven rejoice when one sinner repents and gives his life to Christ. And he went on to give a demonstration to the lady with the lost coin. And when she finds the coin, she rejoices. And Jesus said the same thing. When one sinner comes in and repents, the angels in heaven rejoice. They have a party when one gives their life to Christ. But looking at where the text coming from today, coming from this father that had two boys. And one time, this younger son came to the father, disrespecting the father, came to the father because this younger boy was tired of being home. He was tired of being told what to do. He was tired of being under, I guess, his father's thumb. Seemed like his father had everything to say about it. He couldn't do what he wanted to do, so he wanted to get out of under this bondage. And so he comes to his father and says, Father, give me the portion that befalls me. Because I'm old enough, I'm ready to leave, I want to get out of my home. And I want to say to parents, there come a time when we have to let our children go. There come a time in life when we have to let them go after you have taught them all you have to give them, and they still don't understand, let them go out in life. Let them make mistakes where they can learn from their mistakes. So the love of the father, he gave to both boys. He gave the younger boy a third of the portion that befalls him. And he gave the older boy two-thirds of the portion that befalls him. And it wasn't many days later, this young boy came and got his portion and took off. He left and went to a far, far country. Oh, he was living the life of Robbie. I can imagine in my mind, I can see him when he got his bags packed and his pockets full with money. He feeling better about himself now. He don't have to listen to father. He don't have to follow no rules and regulations. He can go on his own. And I can imagine when he got to the clubs, he was setting the table with drinks and letting them know that all the drinks is on me. Let the good times roll. And he had more friends than he knew what to do. Friends was on every hand. Friends was on every corner. And every time he get ready to, I guess, go out and eat, he would have an entourage to go with him, and he would set the tables up, paying for drinks and buying food. In other words, living big time. But it wasn't long. A famine came into the land. And it reminded me of those who are not so spiritual that they forget about the past. There was a singer that came out some years ago, and if you're not too spiritual to still remember, Bobby Womack. Bobby Womack had a tune come out some years ago, "Nobody Wants You When You're Down and Out." Bobby went on to sing that once I lived the life of a millionaire, spending my money, I didn't care, taking my friends out for a mighty good time, drinking champagne and wine. But soon as my money got low, couldn't find a friend, I know where to go. And that was where this young man is in now. His money is gone, and he don't have nowhere to go, so he becomes in want, and nobody comes to his rescue. But he finds a Gentile that's out with some hog farms. And you know, the Jews didn't deal with Gentiles, and they didn't deal with hogs, swine. But here is something called got to have and need more. When got to have and need more step in, he forgot about his moral religious, because his stomach was hungry and he had nowhere to go, so he was feeding, better known as slopping hogs. He was slopping hogs. And the slop that he was slopping, he got so hungry that he was eating the slop with the hogs. And finally he came to himself while he was eating that slop. He came to himself and his light jumped on in his head. He said, "You know, my father back at home have hired servants that have food to throw away. Here I am, my father's son, and I'm out here starving. I'm going to get up from here and go home to my father, because I was sick of home at first. But the more I think about it, I can think about that swimming pool in the backyard. I can think about hired servants that were at my beck and call. I can think about a good clean bed that I could sleep in. And here I am with nowhere to go, no place to stay. I'm going home to my father." And one thing about a father's love, what I want to do, I want to paint the father as a God figure. I want to paint the older brother as a Jew, and I kind of want to paint the younger brother as a Gentile. So when he goes back home, he comes in distance of his sin distance of his father. And when he comes in that distance, his father's love has never diminished. His father had been waiting on him. His father had been looking for him. And I can imagine his father was praying for him to return. Because the love of a father runs deep. The love of a father is long. The love of a father is patient. And he waits diligently for his son. And when he sees his son from afar off, he runs out to meet his son and to hug him and to kiss him. He runs to let that son know that I'm glad you're home. And he calls for his servants. "Bring out the robes. Bring out a ring. My son is barefoot. He put some shoes, sandals on his feet. And let us kill the fattest calf. Because my son that was lost, now he is found. Let us party and get married." And the party began. Music began popping. Acting began. That food began to smelling good. Everybody was in the party room. And the older son
which I'm going to call the Jew, was at the field working. Now, the younger son, the Gentile, is coming for the party. And father is like the God. So when the older son hears about all this music going on, he asks one of the servants, what's happening? The servants say, well, your brother is home. And your father has hosted a party. Come on, let's go to the party. He said, food is moving, food is smelling. Music is going on. The wine is flowing. Come on. The older brother got mad. He's the self-righteous. He's the one mad. Now, he don't want to go in. He want to insult his father's intelligence. Now, his father owns it all, but he want to insult his father's intelligence. But by his father owning it all, he didn't have to come out and talk to his son. He could let his son go on by his business. But the father lowered himself. Come out. Just like God lowered himself. Come down through 42 generations to talk to you and I, to direct us back to him. He humbled and lowered himself. And when the father came out and talked to the son, and he told the son how much he loved him, and you've always been with me. But the son was bidding and saying that you've never done this to me. I've been here with you. I've never left you. I've been right by your side. I've been obedient. But you haven't even killed a goat for me and my friend. But here is this brother who done spent all his money up, come back home broke, and you set up a party for him. And isn't that just like, and the son said, that's not fair. How many of us want God to be fair? We don't want God to be fair with us. Because if God would be fair with us, all of us would be in hell right now. If God would be fair. Because none of us have been what he wanted us to be. All of us have messed up. The older son was the self-righteous. He's like the Pharisees, the Jews, self-righteous. The younger son, he's like the Gentile. He messed up. And he's coming back home. And the father was having a party, a good time. And it's sort of like if I bring it on home to the church. Many of us who've been in the church all of our lives sometimes forget who the church belongs to. Sometimes we think the church is ours. But the church is not ours. You want to think of my grandfather, my father did this, my mother did this, that you got a special spot in the church. And when someone from off the street out in the community come to the church, we're looking at them funny. What are they up in here for? What are they looking for? They don't have a job. They don't have this. They don't have that. But they come into the church. But God welcomed them in. He wants them to come on in. We are not all that. We are not all self-righteous. We haven't been all that in our lives. And we must understand that as the Father sits high and looks low, he has a love for us. He has a genuine love for us. And in other words, God, when I think of the goodness of the Lord, what God has done for me, in other words, he's given me a second chance. And not only did he give me a second chance, he's given me a third chance. Not only a third chance, he's given me a fourth chance. Not only a fourth chance, he's given me a fifth chance. He's given me a sixth chance. He's given me a seventh chance. He's given me a chance. Every time I come back to God, he'll give me another chance. And I thank God for what he's done for me. And he doesn't throw up my faults in my face. He looks beyond my faults and bless me with my needs. Talking about the love of a father. Just like the love of the father, this prodigal son. He looked beyond the son's faults and saw the son's need and was glad, and he came into the house. Just like an earthly father is today. When his son gets off the street and gets off of drugs or get a job, straighten up and fly right, the father, the earthly father, is happy and wants to do something spectacular for that son when he changes his mind and go around. But I know it's a few of us in here. And it's a few of us in here today. Like that. And some of us like that older son. That the self-righteousness. And we don't have no reason, or not many reason, to be thankful for forgiveness. But now there's a whole slew of us out there right now. Just like the one that's preaching today, me, myself, we have many reasons to go to the party, to give God praises, because there's been so much I have done that wasn't pleasing in his sight that he had forgiven me for. So I'm ready to go to the party. I'm ready to go eat some fatty calves. I'm ready to drink some of that wine that's flowing. I'm ready to go and give God some praises. I'm not out here by myself. You may be looking at me now, but you look back over your life. You got many reasons to give God some praises. Many reasons to thank him for what he has done. And I want you to know that I'm standing here on the promises of God. If you got a house today, you got a reason to praise the Lord. If you got your own apartment, you got a reason to praise the Lord. If you got your own husband, you got a reason to praise the Lord. If you got your own children, you got a reason to praise the Lord. If you have breath in your body, you have a reason to praise the Lord. I want to thank him for what he didn't do for me. Because he done so much, I am grateful for what he has done. And when I think of the love of the Father, the love of God Almighty, how he woke me up this morning, started me on my way. You got a reason to praise God. You got food in your house. You got a few dollars in your pocket. You got a reason to thank the Lord. You got a car to drive. You got a portion of your health and strength. You got a reason to praise the Lord. So I'm going to the party. I'm going to the party. I'm not going to stay outside. I'm going to go give God some praises and thank him for what he has done. Because when one soul gives their life to Christ, the whole entire heavenly host began to praise him and lift up holy hands because one soul has given their life to Christ. And I'm not going to let this moment pass me by when I don't give God some praises for what he has done for me in my life. And I want you to give him some praises for what he has done for you in your life. Who is he? He's Mary's little baby. He's the bright and morning star. He's the one that has no beginning and got no end. Do you know him, who I'm talking about? He's the one that sits high and looks low. He's the Alpha and the Omega. He's the beginning and the end. He's the one that is worthy of all of our praises, worthy of all of our thanks, and he sits and he listens for us to lift him up, to give him the praises that he deserves. He is our Father of all fathers. He is the one that our fathers patronized after. Because of the love of God, that's how our fathers learned to be fathers, from being watching and patronizing after God. Because God the Father loves us so, so much. He looked beyond our faults. And he blesses us anyhow. Aren't you glad about that? Aren't you glad he woke you up this morning to see another Father's Day? He blesses you to be a father. He blesses you to demonstrate the Father in love. And if you don't have any children, biological children, you can have a father figure to give the Father in love to those who do not have a father. So understand what God has placed in your life. These are big shoes to carry as being a father. Being a father means you are a provider. You're one that looks over a person's faults, and you still bless them in the time of their needs. A father's love is so genuine. And I know many of you out there are probably pondering and wondering, what will I get my father for Father's Day? Fathers are not too particular. You can get them, take them out for a meal, they'll be happy. You can buy them some clothes, they'll be happy. You can get them some sporting outfits, a sporting gear that fathers like to do, they'll be happy. They'll be happy with a few dollars. But the most important thing that you can give your father today, if you grab your father by his hand and look at him in his eyes and say, Father or Daddy, I love you, and you hug him and kiss him, Daddy's little heart will just melt right in his body. That will be the greatest love that you can give to your father, to tell him how much you love him. Love goes beyond, far, deep, and wide. And the father of these two boys demonstrated the love of God. Because the father was saying, my son had been gone, but now he's home, and let us give a party. And when Jesus was giving those parables, he was saying that whenever the man found the sheep, or the lady found the coin, that the hosts of heaven rejoiced. And so it was the same thing with the prodigal son when he came home. They rejoiced, and the father demonstrated the heavenly love from the heavenly Father. And I want to say to all the fathers out there, keep demonstrating that heavenly love from your heavenly Father. And let us go to God in a moment of prayer. Our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name, thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. I pray right now, God, that you would look upon the absent part of all churches as we deal with the coronavirus pandemic. I pray, God, you would give us wisdom, give us character, give us understanding how to handle this COVID-19 that we are up against. I pray, God, that you bless the one who's out of a job, who don't have any place to work out. Pray, God, you would supply them with the resources that they need. And I pray, God, that these churches, I pray you would continue to supply the churches with the resources that they need. I pray, God, that you would just be in the middle of everything that's going on. And I know you are in control, you are in charge. And God, we're going to wait on you. We're going to do all we can. And we're going to bless you, God. And we're going to thank you. Going to thank you even in the middle of this pandemic. And I pray so seriously, God, for our President Donald Trump. God, please bless him. Please open up his eyes to understanding, wisdom, and knowledge. Bless all of his staff. Bless him going and bless him coming, Father, because he really stands in the need of our blessing. And God, bless us. Bless these police departments. Bless all the controversy that's going on over this entire world and in the United States. Blessed we get a handle on how policing need to be handled. Give these men some courage. Give them understanding when they handle it and dealing with people. God, have your way in this service today. In Jesus' name we do pray. Amen. At this time, if we have anyone that's listening to us out there on the air that have been inspired by the word today.
Maybe you've been contemplating giving your life to Christ, but you haven't boiled down to it. This would be your prime time for you, as a young man or a young lady, to give your life to Christ. And I want you to know this, this will be the greatest thing you can do in this lifetime, is to give your life to Christ. If you feel that urge to give it to Christ, I want you to repeat these words after me. I want you to look toward heaven and raise your hands and say, Jesus, I am a sinner, but I'm saved by your grace. I'm saved by your death on the cross. You died for my sins, and I believe you died for my sins. And Father God, Jesus, I believe that Father God raised you up from the dead. So my belief turns into salvation. And I know that I'm saved. I'm in your hands, just as the scripture says in Ephesians, I think it's 4 and 30, that we're saved until the day of redemption. And Father, we like you, we thank you, we praise you for that. And I pray that each and every one of you all that gave your life to Christ, that you would find a church that's based on Jesus the Christ, and join that church and help that church to grow and learn more about Jesus, and God will flourish in your life. I pray you would do these things. And I pray also that those who were inspired, if you want to send a donation into the church here at St. John, you can do so. You can come through Givelify, or you can pay on PayPal and be able to give them some information you'd be able to give a donation of your tithes to the church. We'd be more than happy to take your tithes. And if someone out there that needs some prayer or want to talk to Pastor Jackson, you can call the St. John Missionary Baptist Church through the week. I'd be in my office, usually in the afternoons, every day, and call, and I will return your call and have prayer with you and be able to lead you and help you down this road that we're traveling, to let you know it's not as dark as it may appear, but we can make it. And we'd be more than happy to receive any of the contribution that you can give. And even if you can't give anything, please, ma'am, please, sir, pray for us that we will continue to be what God would have us to be. And I want to say to the fathers out there, have a good day today, and all the mothers, take care of the fathers, all the wives, take care of the fathers, and I'm going to say even the girlfriends, take care of your father figure, take care of your boyfriend, take him out to eat. If you do no more, just look at him and tell him that you love him. Love can go a long ways, and men may appear to be tough, and monstrous, bad. You just look at him and say, honey, I love you. And kiss it, he just melt away. He's the biggest one, melt there when you tell him that. And he can feel that love. And whatever you want, if he got it, it's yours. I hate to give that secret away, but if he got it, it's yours. Listen, see you next Sunday. As my grandmother would say, if it's the Lord's will, it's going to be all right. Hold on. Change is coming. It's going to be all right. Hold on. It's going to be all right. All right, all my trustees and deacons, we got a meeting.